Our presentation today features the Northeast Extreme T beam, known as the Next Beam, and the 2014 Rochester, Vermont case study. We are pleased to welcome our presenters, Rita Seraderian, Executive Director of the Precast Prestressed Concrete Institute Northeast, Rob Young, Senior Project Manager in the Structures Section of the Vermont Agency of Transportation, and Joe Carrara, President of J.P. Carrara & Sons, Inc. Rita?
Hello, everyone. All right, I will be presenting first, followed by Rob Young from Vermont, and then Joe Carrara will conclude the presentation today. Okay, I want to give a little bit of background on the development of the Next Beam and how this beam came to the market. But I first have to start with the committee that actually helped develop the section. I have a committee, technical committee, that's been actually running now since 1990. The committee was established with precasters and consultants and DOTs. And since 1990, we've developed actually a fair number of resources related to using precast prestressed concrete bridge systems. But in 2004, the committee decided to venture off and start focusing its activities on ABC. And we actually have developed a fair number of useful tools that are being used regionally. And I do want to touch upon those tools just briefly. We actually developed our first guide for ABC construction. It was posted in 2006. It was a general overview guide to give guidance on how to use precast for substructure work, since we had been starting to see the growth of that product for ABC construction. We did make some updates to this document in 2014. What we actually did when we updated it in 2014 is we actually added a whole bunch of guide details to tie it in with the text that's actually in this document. So if you open up the guide, there's a lot of descriptions that are in parentheses. If you actually click on those parentheses that are in the guide, if you're online, that will actually bring you to the guide details that are kind of discussed in the overview of that other in the literature part of it. So these became useful tools for our region, and once we had concluded the guides for substructure work is really when we started looking at the Next Beam. The Next Beam actually was brought the concept of the beam to the PCI Northeast Bridge Technical Committee. I had seen a shape in a precasters plant that was used for high-level rail platforms, and I thought that it would actually be a perfect shape that could be further developed into a bridge beam. I had reached out to Mike Kumo, who a lot of you have, I think, met over the years through all his activity with the APC Center. And Mike and I sat down and kind of scratched out what this beam could be for bridge elements. We brought it to the committee, and the committee basically gave a green light to further develop it. So some of the advantages why we pushed forward with this new shape was that we felt strongly that it could handle utilities. Predominantly what was being used in the marketplace in the Northeast was box beams. And since a lot of the bridges were heavily amount of utilities across them, didn't quite work basically for handling them. We also felt the box beam was a shape that was not the easiest from a fabrication point of view, so we thought this shape would be a lot easier to manufacture. Shipping and installation costs we also thought would be better with this shape. We strongly felt it could be a really good ABC shape. And for that mid-span bridge arena, really it would be an alternate to the box beam when a state didn't want to use a box beam. So in 2008 was when we finished the first series of guidelines for the Next Beam. F stands for form, which if you look at this 3D graphic, I'll use my little pointer here, is really the Next Beam act as a forming system, the top flange, and we cast an 8-inch deck over it. So that's really why we call it the form version of it. So that was brought to market in 2008. The first bridge actually came out in 2010, so pretty short window to get it into the marketplace. In 2010, we developed the Next D, standing for deck. And then in 2016, we bought a variation combination between the Next D and F to the market. So where does it live within the span range of beams? Our intent was not for the next beam to compete with a bulb T-shape. We felt that for longer spans, you would want to move to a bulb T-shape. So really, it was supposed to be the beam that in your toolkit would be in lieu of a box beam. Maybe a box beam didn't quite work as well. Next beam would then fit that niche. So again, it's another beam for the toolkit, and that was really why it was brought to market. Its working span range, you're looking at 40 to about 80 feet, even though when Joe comes on, he can say that he actually cast one that was 87 feet long. Again, that's kind of out beyond the limit of what we thought it would be specified in. But again, 60 to 80 feet, pretty good span range for this beam. Where does it live on the ABC UTC website? It's under the implemented advanced technologies under the resource tab. What you want to be doing is when you click on that, you'll open up this window, you'll see the next beam there. If you click on the next beam, it will bring you to the PCI Northeast website. I do want to know the guidelines are living on the regional website because it was developed as a regional beam. So that's where you'll actually find some of the sheets that I'm going to be going through in the next series of slides. And so you'd want to download. The download, by the way, is free. There is no charge to download those guidelines. You will find some additional resources on PCI's website in the Bridge Design Manual. Third edition, you will find there is some span charts and section property charts for the next beam that live there. You also can download the Bridge Design Manual, third edition now for free. For those that are not aware of it, it has now become available complimentary at PCI. You do need to register to get it, so you can download that document now. The other place you'll find some next beam information is in the Transportation Research Board's Sharp 2 Innovative Bridge Design for Rapid Renewal ABC Toolkit. So you'll find information in some sheets related to next beam there. So those are two resources for additional information on the next beam. So let's look at the next beam. Typical size of this next beam, what you're looking at is depth ranging anywhere from 24 to 36. It goes up in 4-inch increments. Typical span range, 50 to about 80 feet. Width of the section, and these are going to be some of the things that we'll talk about further in, 8 to 12 feet. So we can do a lot of variations of this actual shape to fit lots of different configurations of bridges. If you start looking at the three types of next beams, again, the next F stands for form. So it has a 4-inch flange. We have an 8-inch deck that would be cast over. If you're a state that likes wearing courses, the wearing course would go over, obviously, the 8-inch cast-in-place slab. There is no forming between the flanges. It's basically casting the concrete directly over it. This shape will easily accommodate any type of vertical curls with the cast-in-place topping. It can also handle camber variations between the members, if there is any. And so there's some benefits by looking at this version. Again, this was the first one that came to market. The next E is a combination of the two. The 4-inch flange is now connecting at the bottom, and we'll show a picture of that further in. And then the 4-inch deck can be cast over. You can make this deck thicker if you want, for instance, some states like 9 inches, so you can easily do that. Advantage of this one over the next F is that you would not be casting as much field cast concrete, taking advantage of the flange by connecting it, but still being able to accommodate vertical curves and any type of maybe variation in camber. The next D, standing for deck, you're now having small closure pores, so there isn't going to be any casting of deck out in the field. So from an ABC point of view, this is actually a very efficient shape. You will have to be mindful of matching the pieces out in the field, so their camber may have to be strongly considered in how the pieces will actually match. And the other thing to note about the shape is it is heavy, so weight constraints, if there's any, need to be considered. Design information for the next beam, when you do pull down the guidelines and take a look at them, they're on an 11 by 17 sheet format. The very first page has information about live load distribution factors. It also had a little matrix chart talking about the variations of the beams and the advantages. Then there's a whole series of profile sheets that talk about different profiles and how to handle them, depending on the next beam that you're looking at, whether it's a D, E, or F. Then we have the beam variations of what those look like. So for instance, the next F, there is no reinforcement coming out. This one, you can go all the way up to the 12-foot width. So that's kind of a nice advantage of this one. The next E and the next D, there is reinforcement coming out of the flange to make the connections out in the field. So unfortunately, you would not be able to push it all the way out into the 12-foot window. You do need to be mindful of shipping. Usually we try to keep everything less than 12 feet so that we don't have any special permitting when we are trying to get the girder to the job site. Section properties are also there, so you'll have a big sheet there of the variations of the three shapes and the section properties to match. Beam combinations of what they might look like. Max span chart, we do have a on one of the sheets what the maximum span may be for depending on the which next beam you're actually looking at. So that will give you some guidance as far as what depth and width of section to consider when you're trying to do some early preliminary design for the element. As far as some other areas to be mindful of, a couple things to be mindful of. A question had come up earlier about cracking. We sometimes get some corner cracking in this beam.
Rita?
Did we lose you?
Yeah,
did we
now.
Lose you?
We're good now. Yes, you
back
did
on?
Momentarily.
Okay.
Yes, thank you.
All right, let me go back because I didn't finish that slide here, if I can go back. So we have a little corner bar because sometimes we end up some small hairline cracking in this area. So we have those in our sheets. You'll find some of that information there. One of the things that we also did to increase durability, especially being up in the Northeast, we're very, very mindful of chlorides and salts and everything that could potentially ruin concrete. So we went with some extra cover on our main reinforcement. So you'll see 2.5 inches to the strand versus maybe 2 inches in other states. We also have made this product a straight strand product with debonding. There will not be any draping of strand in it, especially since the way it's actually manufactured. So that's easier for the fabricator to actually build out. Skews, we do recommend 20 degrees for this product. We have had projects go all the way up to about 45 degrees. You do risk potential cracking, and so that's why we're recommending 20, but that's not to say you can't go over this, because we have. But again, these are some recommendations. I do want to note all of these sheets are guidelines, so you can amend them to what you feel comfortable doing for your own state. For the next D, we have two connections available since it will have a closure pour. For those states that want to use UHPC, we show the straight bar extension for the UHPC connection. For those states that do not want to use UHPC and want to use a non-shrink grout, we also show that detail, which is a hoop bar. So both of them will work, and both of them will be based on what you want to do for your project. Some other fun stuff with the beam, as I mentioned earlier, we can vary the width of this product anywhere from 8 to 12 feet if you're looking at a next F. How does that become an advantage for a state? If you're looking at, for instance, replacing a bridge and traditionally maybe you've been using box beams and you wanted to use box beams, you were stuck with a fixed module of a box beam, whether it's 3 foot or 4 foot wide, and a lot of times it may not match the existing bridge. By going to a next beam, you can dial up the next beam to the exact width that you need to make out the match the existing overall of maybe the existing bridge. So here's a beam that's 9'9" and 11/16". So we can actually do that with this type of a girder. In the past, anything that was kind of a standard shape, you really didn't have that flexibility of adjusting it width-wise. So how is that possible? If you actually, and Joe's going to go through some production shots, but I do just want to quickly note that the reason why we can adjust that width is the newer technology. This side form right here, this blue rail that I'm trying to point out, is a magnetized side form. So what does that mean using magnet technology? They can move this side form in and out depending on the width of the beam that they're actually going to be casting. The other thing that you can do is curvature. I think somebody did ask that question. We actually can curve the flange. The beam legs will still be straight, so it's the flange that actually is curved to basically align with the roadway. So that is something also that can be considered. Additional information that's on my website, again at tcine.org, there's a section for FAQs. So you can go there, and if you have anything specific from a question point of view, you may find the answer there. There is also a paper that was written by Mike Kumo and I when we actually developed the next beam. And basically, you'll give the history of its development. There is also 20 case studies that are currently posted there that you can actually download and take a look at. I want to do make a note here that states that have actually accepted the next beam are 13 so far. It was developed for the Northeast states. So when I say Northeast, it really is New York and the New England states. But since it was developed, some of the other states further south have actually also adopted it. And I do want to note three states that have standards, Massachusetts, New York, and Pennsylvania do have standards for the next beam. So you can actually go there and take a peek at their guidelines. It's actually not guidelines, they're standards. So here's what the first next beam looks like. Pretty wide flanges. For those that have worked in the building market, it looks like a double T. The double T in the building market has got a 5-inch web. This has a 13-inch web, just to give you an order of magnitude of how wide that element is. And our very first project, Maine DOT stepped to the plate. So this is Route 103. It was built again back and started when it first came out. The next thing came out in 2008, and they basically started designing with the product right away. And this bridge was built in 2010. It's a 7-span structure. Beam, next beams were up to about 80 feet. It replaced an existing structure. The contractor worked off of a barge to install them. This is what the beams look like in place. Again, these were next Fs because that's the first one that we brought to market. And there's the finished bridge, so a very nice project. After we finished the next F, we went on to develop the next D. And this project literally came out right after that. This one is a 790-foot long structure. It used a 36-inch deep next beams. Span length on this was 79 feet. This one came in, it was a design build competition. It came in at 10 and a half months ahead of schedule. It was designed for 100-year service life. And in this particular case, the contractor worked off a gantry to install the beams. So again, the beams are heavy, so I do want to note that. So that was how they were able to handle those heavier weights of the element. Again, 10 spans, it was 2 5-foot span continuous units, single span expansion joint at the center. Overall, 790 feet, 36 foot curb to curb, 2 traffic lanes, and you can see the closure pores here in the center. So in summary, I do want to throw out some conclusions. This little chart was developed at the very, very beginning before we actually even developed the next beam on why we would actually want to consider its development. And we did this little side-by-side comparison. We felt that fabrication, from a fabrication point of view, the next beam would be a lot simpler to cast out. It would be a straight strand product, so from a safety point of view, easier from a fabrication and safety point of view, and that we felt it would be more economical. Shipping, that one was easy because you could ship a lot more area of beam, one next beam anywhere from 8 to 12 feet, So you're definitely going to be reducing the number of tractor trailers going to a job site. Cranes were kind of touchy-feely here. We weren't quite sure what to do with the cranes because we felt that the beam was very heavy. And those two projects that we showed, the two main DOT projects, we actually talked to the contractor, and they basically stated that the weight of the beam was not an issue. They went actually on to tout it, saying that especially the one that was working over water, from a safety point of view, they liked it. It was an instant platform. They dropped the beams in. They never had to go underneath the bridge again. So there was a lot of benefits. And again, means and methods by them really minimized what they may have needed for equipment. Installation, we felt a lot easier. You don't have to worry about transverse post tensioning or grouting. You just set it and move it on. And that also had actually held true. So a lot of the assumptions came true, and we do find that this shape is a very efficient, cost-effective shape being used in the Northeast today. And now I'm going to bring you into, I think I'm on time. I'm going to bring you over to Rob, who's going to take over, and he's going to start talking about the Route 73 Bridge 1516 case study in Rochester, Vermont.
All right. Thank you all for attending this webinar. So I'm going to talk about a case project in Rochester, Vermont. Rochester is located in the pretty central located in Vermont. It was a part of four other bridge replacements. Vermont was hit with a tropical storm Irene in 2011. And so we thought the next beam would be a good tool to use to help replace some of the bridges that were removed during Hurricane Irene. So Bridge 15 is kind of a circle down in your right-hand corner of your screen. I want to point out that Route 73 did not have any local routes around these bridges, so we decided that we'd have to do a weekend closure, and that kind of determined the details that we needed to modify the next beam in order to meet this super accelerated schedule. So I'll just put up some photos of four photos of the bridges that we are going to replace. In the upper left-hand corner was a very long structure that was replaced with a steel beam and a concrete deck. The one in the upper right-hand corner was a buried frame. And the bottom two is what we are going to focus on today. Was an existing cast-in-place T-beams. These are almost 90 years old. So we decided to replace those with the next beam. So I'm going to focus on Bridge 15 today. So it's located in a historic district. That determines some features of the bridge that we had to include in order to meet our historic permits. The bridge had a 90-degree curve approaching from the west. It was a 60-foot radius. So we had to make some modifications for the curve. And it was an advisory speed of 25 miles an hour. These two T-beams actually survived Hurricane Irene, but like I said, they were almost 90 degrees, so they were they served their time here in Vermont. But they did have they were deteriorated, and they're also hydraulically inadequate and functionally obsolete. That means it was a too narrow of a bridge. So one of the things that we want to take advantage of with the next beam is we did have a typical beam section, and since 15 and 16 had similar spans, we could kind of had some efficiencies with having similar details with both projects. So that really helped with our design preparation for the project, because we were in a big hurry to get these bridges out into construction. And there are lots of other precast components I'll get a little bit into today, but there was also precast abutments on steel piles and precast wing walls. And like I mentioned before, some of the features we modified is that the curtain wall was integral, is a photo of it on the right. So it's an integral curtain wall and our approach slab seat. And we also fabricated precast approach slabs. And as I mentioned earlier, this was a weekend closure. So here's a plan view of the site. You can see the smaller bridge within the footprint of the next beam. So the next beam bridge was significantly wider, and you can see the curve approaching to the west, and the bridge rail that we incorporated into the project. This was also a mountain road in Vermont, and so we also had a significant grade, about a 5% grade of the next beam, and which also created a sag curve on the bridge. So most of you know, when you have a pre-stressed element, positive camber is usually a good thing. In this case, we had negative camber, so we had to develop a detail to work around that for this project. So here's a layout of the bridge. Another kind of special feature of this project with that 90 degree curve that we had going into the project, we had this flare of the flange in order to increase the shoulder so that trucks can negotiate that corner. And this corner was cast integral with the next beam top flange. So that was a unique feature of this project. We also wanted to reduce time. Because it's a weekend closure, the aesthetic bridge rail had a concrete portion of it, and that was cast integral with the exterior beams as well. So one thing I wanted to point out with this slide is the anchorage for the bridge rail. One of the things when you're trying to accelerate the design, you really need to coordinate with all the subs to do the bridge rail fabrication drawings and then forward those to the next beam fabricator. So there's additional coordination you do ahead of time that is not typical with a cast in place construction. So this sheet just shows the grayed out area here, shows the flare that we had for the corner. The parapet was also skewed at the end as well. The detail on the right was how we dealt with the variation in the flange. So the next beam minimum flange width is 8 inches. And we had a taper about 25 feet from the centerline of bearing to the ends to try to counteract the pre-stress camber and match the profile of the road. So that was a special feature for this project. SCC is a pretty popular mix design in precasters, so that mix had to be adjusted in order to for the concrete to form for the next beam. I just wanted to highlight the secondary pour for the curtain wall. So we have the end curtain wall and the approach slab C was cast at the end of the next beam and delivered that way. So those, again, it's another piece that would not have to be cast in the field. And it's just a layout view showing the dimensions of the end curtain wall. So we kind of went through some evolution with the PCI details since 2010. I think it was the first next beam project. So I just want to kind of point out the things that have changed, and Rita mentioned this a little bit before. We did start out with the headed bars that you can see in the bottom left-hand corner, and we moved toward a hairpin type connection. We also do PBUs or precast decks on steel beams for larger span bridges in Vermont. So we wanted to keep the closure reinforcing steel detail the same. So we adopted the hairpin detail, which is now shown in the PCI guidelines now anyway. We increased the gap between the next beam closure pour. We thought this gave the contractor a little more tolerance. I think it was 8 inches originally. So we increased that to 9. In Vermont, we like to use bare deck bridges. And in order to kind of follow the same suit with the next beam project, the three rail curbless rail that we use is works well with the next beam, but we still have to cast a 2 7/8 high curb in order for the anchorage for that bridge rail. It also eliminates the need to cast a curb for the project. So again, it's one more piece that doesn't have to be cast in the field. And Rita mentioned this earlier. Early on, we didn't have that corner bar and we were getting some cracking at the end of the beam. A lot of times that crack gets cast into the end of the beam, but we added this reinforcing to help mitigate that crack. So I just want to talk about some notes that we evolved, some details that came from the guidelines, and we kind of moved into a different direction in Vermont. We had a note about sandblasting, and that really wasn't what we were looking for. That kind of came from the box beam bridges. But we were really looking for an 1/8 inch exposed aggregate. The picture on the left kind of shows a good photo of the paste removed from the joint. This gives a much better bond with the closure pour concrete. So we, instead of specifying sandblasting, which is really means and methods, we specify 1/8 inch exposed aggregate, because that's what we're really looking for to get that good bond. We also had originally, and for the Rochester project, specified a non-shrink grout. But the contractors didn't really want to deal with the bag mix in the field. So they worked with the producers and they developed their own mix. And as we move forward with our specifications with other next beam projects, we decided to go ahead and, rather than keep specifying a grout, since the industry was producing a concrete mix, we developed a special provision. We call it a high performance concrete rapid set. It has the same properties as a non-shrink grout. It has the aggregate. So an extended grout, essentially concrete. So we just decided to call it what it was. And we use the same rapid set concrete to fill the pile cavities. And we use it for the closure pour for the next beam. Some lessons learned as we went through a couple of next beam projects is that if you have a cross slope that's greater than 2%, you may want to have a separate mix design. So that your joint stays flush with that cross slope. The photo on the left shows some forming for the next beam, for the closure pour. We'd like to show an option of including inserts. This is just another method for the contractor to attach their formwork. The one on the right works okay, but having those inserts is a pretty easy way for the contractor to attach their forms. So we have that note as well. We don't have a lot of research on the closure pour concrete, so we decided to kind of the belt suspenders, we're gonna provide a spray applied membrane. Vermont uses a torch applied membrane for a lot of our bridge projects in the past. We think the spray applied is a much better, higher quality product, and also allows for traffic to travel on the spray applied, so the pavement can be outside the closure period. So I'll go through some photos of the project in Rochester. Just some quick photos of some demolition. You notice these are kind of side-by-side excavators here. In Vermont, we have a lot of projects where the contractor has to work inside the right-of-way. So that's this is a pretty typical kind of scenario for bridge demolition. I didn't have any good photos of the pile installation, but this is a single row of piles, an integral abutment. And there's a pile cavities. The piles are sticking up about 2 feet above the bottom of the pile cap, shown in the upper right-hand corner. And the precast approach slabs have pockets underneath, and they slide over the piles. And you can see the tube where the concrete or the rapid set concrete is delivered into the pile cavity. Then after the abutments are set, it's a pretty common erection method to use a slider beam, essentially a longitudinal slide. The dolly for one end is shown there with the yellow beams. And there's beam one ready to go in upper left-hand corner. So the truck, what happens is the crane picks one end of the next beam up, they pull out the dolly. And so the truck backs up onto the slider beam. I didn't have a full picture of that, but the truck is on the other end. And the next beam is sitting on the dolly and the truck backing the next beam across in the upper right-hand corner. And then when they get all three beams, like I said, there's minimum right-of-way. So the slider beam is typically in the place of the fourth beam. So the fourth beam is stacked on top of the existing next beams that are in place. They go ahead and remove the slider beam and then they place the fourth beam. So the upper left just shows the bottom forming that they came up with. It worked okay, but having the inserts would also be useful. The upper right-hand corner shows the closure pour going in. The big picture in the middle, you can see that they're forming up. Looks like they're using some aluminum to form up the approach slab seats, and they're forming up the closure pour. And the bottom right-hand corner shows the approach slabs. And the next beams with the closure pour complete. The spray applied membrane is shown in the upper left-hand corner. And I wanted to show the upper right-hand corner shows that the cast aggregate So you need the cast aggregate because that surface is pretty slick. So you want to put the aggregate down before you allow traffic onto the bridge. And the center picture shows the bridge complete. And that just shows a nice overview of the completed project with that 90-degree curve that was west of the project. I think I'll hold off on questions till the end, but I think I'll turn it over to Joe at this time.
Okay, thanks, Rob. So hello, everybody. As Rob mentioned, I'm Joe Carrara with JP Carrara & Sons. We're a third-generation, family-owned precast fabricator located in Middlebury, Vermont. And we produce structural and architectural precast components. And the Accelerated Bridge program here in Vermont has been a huge part of our company's success in the last 7 years. So we do appreciate that. So again, we're focusing on, we provided precast components for two of the four bridges on this project in Rochester, bridges 15 and 16. And you can see here a quick table. So for bridge 15, for instance, there were 7 approach slabs, 4 wing walls, 4 abutment components, and 4 next beams with integral curtain walls and railings. And in this column here, you can see, get a feel for the weights of these components. That's always a critical item for the contractors when it comes to, you know, installing these products, and for the fabricators. Not all fabricators have the same, you know, lifting capabilities. So different projects may be broken up in different ways, with more pieces or fewer pieces, depending on the fabricator. So you can see the approach slabs in this bridge weighed about 29,000 pounds, the wing walls about 20,000, and the abutments about 93,000. And the heaviest next beam with the integral curtain walls and barrier on it weighed 143,000 pounds. And bridge 16, similar fashion, there were 6 approach slabs, 4 wing walls, 4 abutment components, 3 next beams. And you can see the weights over here for that. So from a precaster's perspective, there's several things we look at during the bid process. The sizing of the abutment components, you know, there's typically there are footings, abutments, wing walls, approach slabs. And again, as I mentioned previously, the maximum weight is a concern both for the fabricator and the contractor. There may be cases where there's limited crane access, and they can only handle a certain amount of weight to reach across the bridge. If they can't get around, we can't make deliveries to one side or the other. So we have to size accordingly. Height is a big concern when it comes to abutment components. We pour the abutment components. You'll see further down my slideshow, we have some good photos of fabrication of these components. You'll see we pour the abutment segments vertically because they have these large, typically 24-inch diameter sleeves in there to accommodate to connect to the H-piles. So when they get to be too high, it can be problematic from lifting it in the plant to shipping it down the road. That's a consideration. We try to stick around 12'2". And a width of 12 feet is nice to maintain, to minimize width of components to 12 feet to eliminate the need for, you know, escort vehicles when shipping these components. Next beam considerations for us, we look at, you know, handling of these. When they get to be long and heavy, we typically have to specify a vertical lift requirement on the beams. So the contractors at bid time are asking us these questions, you know, can we pick it with one crane with a 60-degree sling angle, or do we need to do a vertical lift? Because for them, that could, they may need 2 cranes or a picking beam or something like that. So that kind of plays into their price on their project, on their bid. And then for us, we look at the beam plus the weight of the dolly that we ship it on and the tractors. They get to be over 100 feet in length and over 150 pounds in weight. They're considered a superload, and there are special requirements for permitting and route surveys, escort vehicles, police escorts. It gets complicated, so we have to be fully aware of all that at bid time, obviously. And then, of course, the shipping route. We evaluate the shipping route to the project to make sure we don't see any concerns. If we do, we bring it up during the bid, you know, prior to the bid to the contractors, and it goes back to the state. And then schedule, we have to look at, for instance, in the state of Vermont, they have what's called the BCP, a bridge closure period. So we look and see when that is, what the duration is, what our current workload is, and come back out of schedule looking at, you know, shop drawing development and approvals material lead times, because oftentimes there's numerous types of rebar that's specified, from stainless steel to epoxy to a Z-bar, which is a dual-coated product, which is actually no longer available. But you'll see that in the upcoming photo, because it was used on this project, but it's no longer available. But there are extended lead times with the specialty rebars like stainless steel and Z-bar. So we have to factor that into the equation, our fabrication time, and then we have to have it all, typically we have to have all the components fabricated, approved by the state in our yard prior to shipping and prior to the bridge closure period beginning. So they know all the products been fabricated and accepted and ready for shipping. So there's no delays when the clock's ticking. Component costs, these are just some ranges on average projects, and of course, you can go up or down from these depending on how customized the product, the components are. So for abutment components, they range from $800 to $1,800 per cubic yard, fabricated and delivered to the job site. The $800 a yard pertains like, to the approach slabs are typically the least expensive component. And then the abutment components get up to around 1,800, can get up to there, and some can be more, as I said. The next, F-beams, that's with the 4-inch flange. They range from $40 to $55 per square foot fabricated and delivered. The next E-beam, $75 to $90 fabricated and delivered. And a little cost comparison, as Rita had mentioned in her presentation, you know, box beams were typically used for these shorter spans. Now the next beams are a substitute for that. And as a comparison, next F-beams are about half the cost of box beams. You eliminate the grouting and post-tension required. The next F does require a cast-in-place deck. Box beams may or may not. And obviously it's a lot less, it's fewer loads, which is helpful for the contractors on site, logistically, you know, staging these loads. So there's a lot of benefits to the fewer pieces that the next beams offer. The next E-beams, they're more expensive and they're comparable to the box beams. However, they don't require a cast in place deck or grouting or post tensioning, and again, fewer loads. So design considerations. For the next beams, we recommend that, you know, designers adhere to the PCI standards. Strand patterns, in particular, we often see strand patterns that deviate from the standard locations that are specified, and these forms that the fabricators have, they're either what we call a self-stressing form, where the form itself takes the load of the pre-stress, or it's the form that's placed between two stressing abutments. But either way, the strand patterns are fixed, and you can't deviate from that. And you'll see later in my slides why that's the case. And stem geometries, we've seen some variations from the standard stem geometries, and the form is a fixed form, and it's not adjustable in that regard. However, they are customizable, as we discussed earlier on here, that you can vary the flange width and thickness, and you can skew the ends of the beams. 3 degrees, I think, is what PCI recommends, and we have done many projects between 30 and 45 degrees, and as Rita pointed out, the heavier the skew, the higher the probability and the longer the cracks will be. Because when these beams are, when you cut the cables free in the bed after it's cured, the beam cambers up in the bed and it wants to bear at the acute corners of the of each end of the beam. So it's kind of torquing it in the form and causes cracking between the top flange and the interface, the top flange and the stem. And again, we've added, the committee has come up with adding this crack control rebar that Rob pointed out that does help mitigate the cracking. It won't eliminate it, but it mitigates the extent and the frequency of it. And of course, we can do curved and flared flanges as well. And another design component that's become more prevalent throughout New England in our market area is a camber monitoring and control program. So typically the tolerance would be, you know, a deviation from design camber of 3 ± 3/4 inch, and then a differential camber between adjacent units of 3/4 inch plus or minus. So what we do, so we have here, so producer verified cambers for release, erection, and long-term time steps. So the designers typically provide that information that they've calculated on the contract drawings, So we will take and recalculate those. Number one, just checking for errors, because we have had cases where there were errors in the calculations, and then we were trying to hold those two, you know, the tolerances, which were unachievable because it was incorrectly calculated to begin with. So we check it for that, number one. And then we also use a revised calculated modulus elasticity, which is my next bullet down. And there's two formulas for that, as most designers are aware of. We have the ASHTO formula and the ACI formula. And then we've also begun recently measuring the modulus elasticity for our 6,000, 8,000, and 10,000 pound mixes. And we started with our 10,000 pound mix because we're finding most next beams are more in the 10,000 pound range. And so we use a compressometer, extensometer per ACI C469. And we're really just developing and gathering that information right now. We haven't actually used it yet. We are finding though in general that the modulus is less than what's calculated per the ASHTO equation. And the ACI equation does provide a lower result as well. And I think it's pretty much accepted that the ACI equation is more applicable to higher strength mixes. So we check that, and then we present that the revised camber calculations and estimates to the state, and then from that we base our camber control program. So we monitor the camber growth at each phase, and as it approaches the limits, we have a system that we calculate the amount of weight it takes to deflect the beam a quarter of an inch. We do it in quarter inch increments. So we'll weigh it down, then we'll continue to monitor it, make sure it's still not, if it's still growing, then we weigh it down again. But if it's not, we just monitor it. And we're monitoring the adjacent beams in the project and making sure we're within the acceptable tolerances. So that's become an important factor. And we keep the contractor in the loop in that as well, so he can accommodate. Before we ship, he has all that information on the cambers at the time of shipment, so he can make adjustments either to his bridge seats or he has, you know, steel shims in place to shim off the bearing pads as required. Abutment component design. So the lifting design for the abutments can get really tricky because they tend to be, you know, kind of, you know, funky, complex geometries with cheap walls, the pipe sleeves taking up space and so forth. That's definitely a challenge. And we had some projects that, you know, we came close on not even knowing how to handle them. We ended up figuring it out in the long run, but it can get tricky, just pointing that out. Coordination of component connections, rebar and splicer covers is something to keep in mind. Oftentimes, you know, the rebar splicer obviously is larger in diameter than the rebar, and you will have reduced covers there. So that's always a point of interest for designers. So here we are. This is a fabrication of a match cast abutment for the Rochester bridges. So the first piece, I don't know if you can see my cursor down here. So the first piece was cast, and then was picked up and moved off the pallet here, leveled up, and then we pour the adjacent piece against it. And you can see the components of the fabrication here. So you have this yellow rebar, it's the dual-coated rebar. It's galvanized and epoxy-coated. You can see the 24-inch diameter galvanized pipes that the drops down over top of the H-piles. And you can see the post-tensioning ducts that run through the piece. Here are the completed abutments. They're turned back to back, but they butt to each other here. In the field, there's an epoxy adhesive applied to the end of the beam. We erect the second piece tight to that, and we post tension it promptly once it's in place. It's a bit of a fuzzy photo, but this is a photo of a wing wall being fabricated. So the exposed to view face is the form face. And we use splice sleeves to connect it to the abutments. So you can see the grout ports of the sleeves sticking out here. And the green epoxy-coated NMB splice sleeves that we use are cast into the panel there. This is a view of completed approach slabs with the projecting hairpins and exposed aggregate finish in the keyway. And as Rob mentioned, initially we were sandblasting that, the keyway, to get the rough and finish they're looking for. And then it developed into more, they want a little bit deeper with an eighth inch, you know, projection of the aggregate. So we actually use a retardant in the form now. We paint onto the form, and the product is stripped and moved out to the yard. We just wash it off, and it provides this nice quarter inch or eighth inch deep amplitude for a good bonding of the shear key. Okay, so this is next beam form. Our form happens to be 250 feet. And every producer has a different length form. So that's going to be, so it'll be a, you know, it's a function, how many beams you can pour at one time is a function of your form length, obviously. So different fabricators will have different capabilities in that regard and different efficiencies in that regard. So you can see here, this is our self-stressing form. The form itself takes the load of the strands. The strands run through these big stressing blocks. They're a 12-inch thick piece of steel. So it'd be very difficult to try to drill new hole patterns, and not to mention that the form is designed for a specific pattern for each depth beam. So you really should not be varying from that design, that standard strand pattern. So you can see here this wooden header, so the skewed end of the beam, might be a little difficult to see, this projecting rebar, and the end of the beam is coped so that we're able to pour on the end of the beam, the integral curtain wall that's poured on as a secondary pour, and you'll see that coming up. Just a view of the beginning setup of the beams. There's three beams in this form. It's a little bit hard to see that. So you can see the pre-stressing cable barely running down through the stem. These are all the shear bars, the transverse bar, the transverse reinforcement. And because the beam is skewed, so in the middle of the beam, all the bars are perpendicular to the length of the beam. And they're flared at the ends to create this, to accommodate the skew. So this is a view of the wooden side forms here are custom because it has a variable flange thickness at the end. And we oftentimes will have to add an additional mat of steel. Now these are next D beams, so they have two mats to begin with. Now there's three in this particular setup here. You can see there's a lot of reinforcement there. It can get complicated. It's a complicated setup, but our team has it down pretty well. Another view showing our lifting devices. We use pre-stressing cable for lifting devices. And this photo is the formwork for the secondary pour for the curtain walls on the end of the beam. And there's a finished product. And the barrier was poured as a secondary pour, obviously, as well, off to the side here. So this is the sort of the crux of that particular project, this piece right here, with all this going on. So this is a very custom, you know, next beam. So you can see this is the seat for the approach slabs. And the approach slabs have corresponding sleeves that may drop down over top of these rods. This is a view looking down the top of the beam, so you can just get a view of the kink of the barrier and the flange extension. And we did pour the extension of the flange monolithic with the pour of the next beam. We just modified the formwork off the side of our form to accommodate that. Close-up view, this was a sandblasted finish. But since this project, we have gone to a retarded finish, which looks a little bit different, gives a little bit more exposure to the aggregate. So here we are now shipping one of the abutment components. It's close to 100,000-pound piece. It's a lot of load in a very concentrated area on the trailer. So we have to use specialized equipment trailers. This happens to be a quad equipment trailer. And you can see how we handle them here in the shop, and they're handled in a similar fashion out in the field. And this is a drop deck trailer versus an equipment trailer. This piece is a little bit lighter, so we can get away with that with a triaxle trailer, just so you get a sense of how these components are shipped. And this is another equipment trailer. This is a triaxle versus a quad. This is how we ship these long next beams on these dollies. These are self-steering remote control dollies. Just another view from the side, and then staging them on the job site. And you've seen that picture. Okay,
Excellent presentations. Wow. So good. Lots of information there. Thank you, Rita, Rob, and Joe. Paul Lyles, former Georgia State Bridge Engineer, will now moderate the Q&A session. Paul?
Yes, Mary Lou. We have just a few minutes to go over Q&As. And I've broken these questions down. We had a number of questions that came in ahead of time and then during the presentation. But I've got them broken down to that are job-specific questions. And then there's a bunch of questions about the next beams in general. So we'll just try and see where we can get to. Now, when we run out of time, the questions will all be answered and posted online in the future. So don't despair if your question doesn't get answered. It will be. The first question we have is just a general question about this specific job. And who did the design? Was it V-Trans that did it or a consultant? And then was the project funded by FHWA and did you need any sole source spec?
It was a consultant project, VHB, northeast part of the country. And yes, it was a federal highway. It was 80% federal, 20% state.
Okay, and was there any sole source spec requirements?
No, the next beams are not proprietary, and there were no proprietary components for the next beam project.
All right, that's fine. And then specific questions on the design. There was a question about the durability. I think you mentioned that you had the membrane for that. The type of concrete for the beams, what strength?
The beams are 9,000.
Yeah, 9,000.
Okay. And then type of reinforcement. You mentioned the special reinforcement that maybe wasn't available anymore. But I don't think it matters on this. It was a question that came on during the session that said, do you really recommend epoxy coating for the rebar or and also for the strand? And that may be a state question, but Rita may want to address that.
Yeah, unfortunately, the requirements of the rebar, usually the pre-stressing strand has been black in our region,
okay.
But the rebar has varied, so we have some states that do epoxy, some states that have done, some states that have played around with stainless steel, obviously Vermont played with that dual-coated bar, so I'm not going to say that there's one way that everybody does in this region. It has been varying. So.
Okay, that's fine.
Stainless steel is more prevalent, though, now.
Okay. Came in about a question on, was high-performance concrete used in the precast in the closure cores? That was no. There was a question, though, about the nominal design life of the completed bridge. And
it was 75-year design life.
Yeah. The one that was in Maine was designed for 100-year life, so that would be required by what the state wants. So.
Okay, and there was a question that came on the closure pour about what was the strength of the closure pour?
7,000.
Okay, and then what was it when it was open to traffic?
The strength of the closure of the concrete?
Yes.
I think I had a minimum of 4,000 PSI for loading.
For opening to traffic, okay. That's fine. Let me see. There was a question about polyester polymer concrete is an acceptable material for the closure pour.
Yeah. I've not heard of that. No.
Okay, that's fine. There was a big question here about the actual cambers. Did they match the predicted cambers?
Rob, you want me to comment, or would you like to?
Yeah, I mean, as far as it, you can comment as far as how it came out in the fabrication, as far as it was set up, it met the profile.
Yeah.
Okay.
That particular project didn't have a camber management requirement to it, but they did. Those beams are relatively on the shorter side, and they're pretty stout with the thickened flange and the curtain walls on it, and all. So they ran the cambers were very. They were very close to each other. They were pretty consistent.
Okay, that's fine. Was the modulus of elasticity determined by test or by formula, or maybe both?
Yeah, so I think I kind of touched on that during my presentation, but now we're working toward measured modulus elasticities for each of our mix designs, so it will provide a more accurate estimate of camber each time step. That's okay. Sort of the movement now.
Mm-hmm. All right, that's fine. Just maybe one more, two more. So, was there anything about cracking prevention during shipping and lifting of the units?
It's not much you can really do after they're cast, but all the cracking, most of it typically occurs upon detention of the beams.
Okay.
It can get exacerbated during installation if the bearing seats aren't exactly at elevation and it torques the beam. It can cause the existing cracks to get a tad longer, but they can be sealed properly to maintain the durability.
Okay. There's a question here about, do you need any mid-span diaphragms?
No.
Or in next beams in general? No. Okay.
No.
And then how do you account for the cross slope of the deck?
Yeah, that was in the, in this particular case, that was in the overpour.
Okay.
But on other projects, you would have to be a straight beam. I don't know, Joe, have you ever done one with a crown?
Yes. Yeah. So if there's a crown in the middle, they'll lay out the next beam so that there's a joint there at the middle.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they slope each way.
Okay. All right. It is a little bit after 10 after, 11 after, and I think we're going to have to end the question.
Paul, let's go another 5 minutes just because
okay.
We have so many questions, and
Authorit
has given us a note that we can do that.
Okay. Then continuing on with the questions about the specific project, there was a question about were there any longitudinal cracking in the joints? I might have mentioned that one.
Yeah, no,
I think that was a general question, but we haven't seen any longitudinal cracking in the joints.
Okay. Product delivery, what type of trailer is being used to deliver the beams? You covered that very well. You showed it, and I think that's pretty good. Rita, you also showed some stuff about delivery. And Joe showed it, so we'll let that one go. See, then there was a cost comparison versus typical stringers. And I don't know how you showed some cost data, but is it comparable to stringer bridges? It's got some real neat things about it, about not having to form it. It's almost like you can build, by using the double stems, it's like delivering one next beam is worth two beams conventionally.
Yes, that's correct. I think, I don't know, did Mike Kumo get on? I don't know if he's on.
But yeah, I'm here.
I think cost-wise, what we've been seeing in the region is that it's a very cost-effective system compared to stringer bridge.
My one comment is the cost that Joe presented, our Northeast costs, our costs tend to be a little higher than most of the country. So the comparison, it's good that Joe showed a comparison of the box beams. So compared to stringer bridges, they're very cost competitive. It'll vary from place to place in the country.
All right, let's go on to general next beam questions. There were some questions that came in about possible overhang reinforcement to withstand rail post anchorage crash forces. Has that been looked at very much? And there was also a question about, are there any precast barrier rails that is crash tested that the PCI members can use?
This is Mike Kumo. I can handle this one. The answer is the design for the next D beam is just like a cast in place deck. You can design the overhang just as you would if it was a stringer bridge. There is enough room to do that. As far as precast railings, there is research ongoing right now through the ABC center at FIU. They're working on several precast barrier options. Currently, there really isn't a heck of a lot out in the field there. There are other universities I know that have looked at this as well. So there's not a lot to be choosing right now, but hopefully in the near future.
Okay, there was a question that came in during the session. It's asked if the beams are simple spans, I think. There was a question, are they continuous? Is there any ever thought on making them continuous at all?
The main DOT project, they were designed for continuity. They were designed continuous. They had
okay.
continuity reinforcement coming out of them, and that was a design for a 5-span.
Okay.
They can be made continuous. They can also be made with full integral abutments. As opposed to the semi-integral abutment that was presented, which is a very good detail, but if you want a full integral abutment, that can be done as well.
Okay. There were some questions here about availability. And you presented a slide, Rita, I think it was 23, that showed the different states that were using it. And it said the address availability of forms in the Midwest, and also maybe the initial cost to a fabricator. And then there was another question about the availability of forms maybe in the DC. They said in 2015 they weren't readily available. I don't know if you want to make
any comments. In the Northeast is much more readily available. We have producers all the way down to Virginia that now have the form. So this region, for Virginia up, you have fabricators.
Right.
But in the Midwest, that I'm not aware of anybody out that far. But in the Northeast corridor, yes, there's a lot of fabricators that have the form.
To add to that, there are 10 fabricators that I'm aware of in the Northeast region.
Okay. I know down here in Georgia, the fabricators were real worried about having to buy the forms and then never having, only used one time. So if you want to really start using them, that's great for the fabricator.
Mike Como, just to throw in there, that's the great thing about our PCI Northeast committee, having owners and fabricators on the same committee, that the owners stressed a commitment to using these sections, which gave the fabricators a good feeling to make the investment in the forms, knowing that they actually would be seeing bridges on the street.
Okay. That's fine. There was a question about skew limitations. We mentioned that about recommended 20 degrees, but then Joe, I think you may have mentioned some bigger skews, but
we successfully fabricated up to 45 degrees. We do have some cracking going on that you need to address. You have to accept the fact that you're going to have cracking, but that it can be repaired.
Okay. Then they asked about the curb line.
Can I add to that real quick? So a lot of the cracks, they occur at the ends. The majority of the crack is typically encased in the back wall pore.
Okay.
So the worst part of the crack is typically at the very end, and it's going to be encased in the back wall pore or a curtain wall, precast pore.
Okay. Then the curved alignment, you showed one, Rita showed one, I think, that had a curved alignment on the side, the overhang. And then a question came up about do you have a picture of that? Someone was interested in that. It came up during
I showed that in my presentation, the curved face, that you can do the curved flange to follow the roadway. So
yeah, the question that came up, do you have one in the bed, shown in the casting bed? But that's fine. It's pretty easy to form, I think.
Maybe we could have one more question.
Okay, it says, can straight bar laps be used with UHPC? You answered that during the presentation.
I answered that already.
Yeah. I think that's pretty well got us. There's about three or four more questions that haven't been answered, but we're pretty well out of time. So Mary Lou, do you want to?
Yes, thank you so much.
Okay.
Thanks again to Rita and to Rob and Joe for your interesting, informative presentations and your responses during the Q&A session. Lots of questions coming in. That's great. Thanks also to Mike Como with CME Associates, Inc. for participating on the Q&A panel, to Paul for moderating the Q&A session, and to Masa Farzad, PhD student at FIU, for managing the web room. Thanks to each of you for participating in today's webinar, and we look forward to your participating with us again next month on March 15th. This concludes today's webinar. Thank you.